So you're all expecting a talk at the quantum session, but as already announced, this will not have much to do with quantum or post-quantum cryptography. But if you want to be a bit in stay in that area, I will try to explain what white box crypto is. It's related to secure software, and try to think, because not many people have looked actually into this, how we can turn the post-quantum crypto proposals into white box solutions. And that would be a fantastic research area. All right, so this talk is based on work with Charles Houbin, Will Michiels, and Phil Teuwe, all at NXP at the time we worked on this, and currently both Charles and Phil are at Quark's lab, and our paper was already presented this summer at CHESS. So what is white box crypto? So in order to understand this, let me try to give an overview. When we talk about crypto, we often talk about you need to understand who is the attacker, where is this adversary, is it internal, is it external? When you think of internal, it can be the user, it can be a virus. And what is realistic for your particular use case? So the old way of thinking about this is the black box model. So you assume that the endpoint are trusted parties and the attacker observes data being transferred. So this is from the, let me call it the 80s. And then in the 90s, there was this new model, which people refer to as the gray box model. It's related to hardware implementations. And imagine you have a smart card, for instance, with your crypto algorithm running on it. It was shown that if you measure, for instance, the power or other external information, meta information about this implementation while this running, you can use this information to extract the private key material used during the execution of this cryptographic algorithm. So then we come to the white box model, which is related to the gray box model, but it's not related to hardware, it's related to software execution. So now, for instance, think about a cryptographic algorithm running on a device you own, but it's implemented in software. So an easy example, for instance, is a mobile device. And again, we assume that the adversary can be the owner of that device. So it can even be the user of the device. And still, we want to protect the private key from being extracted, even by the user running this cryptographic implementation. So, and this setting, where you want to, among other things, ensure that the cryptographic key cannot be extracted from the software implementation, is referred to as the white box attack model. So why are we interested in this white box attack model? Who is actually using this? So this was originally proposed early 2000s in a setting of digital rights management. And think here of streaming content from somewhere, for instance, to your setup box. And then the party who is streaming the movie to you does not want you to have the key which can decode this movie, because then you might be able to give this key to a friend, and then he can watch this movie as well. Then there was more or less a decade, not too much attention to white box crypto, until a couple years back, when it was a renewed interest in this technology after the introduction of HCE. So HCE stands for host card emulation. And the idea behind this is that it emulates in software your NFC, so near field communication. And the idea is that it replaces the secure element, or it emulates the secure element in software. And this is, for instance, in practice used that you can pay with your mobile phone or take a train or any other transit. And in practice, how is this cryptographic key in this implementation then protected? Because why do you want to protect this? You don't. If the user would have this cryptographic key, it could, for instance, do a rollback attack, which means I pay my fare for my train, I extract the key, and I just upgrade to any other amount I have, or I roll back the data I had, and then I have the previous fare, and I actually didn't pay at all. And how this is done in practice is with this, then you are in this white box attack model, and if you have a cryptographic implementation secure in this model, people call this a white box implementation. And we see an increasing demand of this in practice. So in 2014, Visa and MasterCard announced their support for host card emulation. And in these payment protocols, if you implement them in software, it is a requirement that you protect it with white box cryptography. And according to these studies, we will only see an increase of these HCE solutions in practice and phones and other mobile devices which actually support this technology. So in practice, what do they actually protect? It's mainly symmetric crypto. So we're talking about AES and triple DES. And how these keys are really protected. Already in practice, if you have a mobile phone, for instance, not only payment, but also the apps which are allowed to install from your Play Store or any other app store you have on your phone, it's very likely that this is protected with white box cryptography. So when you think about this, how would you actually try and solve this problem? What should we think about? Why do normal security cryptographic implementations and software not work? Because it was already shown actually before the invention or the introduction of white box crypto by Shamir van Someren that if you just load your crypto key into memory and you would just scan your memory and look at the location with the highest entropy, that with very high probability this is the location of your cryptographic key. And then you can just dump it, extract it, and then you have extracted the key. Another easy way how to extract the key is with a technique called S-box blanking attack. So you just have your implementation of, for instance, AES. You just replace the S-box with all zeros, and then that gets XORed in, and you just the implementation outputs the key. So we need something more advanced. So then, of course, the question arises, is a white box implementation even possible? The answer, of course, is no, because if you want to build an ideal white box AES implementation, you could just create one big lookup table for one specific fixed key, but this will not be very practical, because even modern mobile phones don't have this much storage. In practice, what people propose, so in the original paper in 2002 by Chow and others, they proposed a technique where you replace every algorithmic step in the algorithm, in this case of AES, with a lookup table. And then the goal is that you try to obfuscate these lookup tables by putting input and output encodings on calls to this lookup table. So on the right here, you see a nice overview how then the flow of the algorithm would look like, and then this already gives rise to a much smaller implementation, but still orders of magnitudes larger than the original AES, and their proposed solution was around 700 kilobytes, and you actually didn't compute anything here, it was just a sequential series of table lookups in the hope where it was fixed for one particular cryptographic key in the hope that the attacker is not able to deduce any information about the key actually used and partially stored in these lookup tables. In practice, however, in the remainder of the talk, I will be discussing how to extract the private key from a white box implementation. But in practice, you would use much more than just white box. I just wanted to tell you, to give you a bigger overview. In practice, people apply code obfuscation, anti-debugging, just to make the life of the hacker more annoying, and different platform binding techniques, which all serve different purposes. Like I said, if you want to have anti-rollback protection or something which is called code lifting, you want to protect against these types of attacks as well. So code lifting, for instance, is the simple attack that you don't want to extract the private key, but you just copy, because it's software, you just copy the entire software solution, put it on another phone, for instance, and if you then run your cryptographic algorithm, you essentially have copied the private key because it was embedded in there, and you get the same functionality. So if you want to protect against these types of attacks, you need other types of countermeasures. I will be solely focusing on extracting the private key from the implementation. And last year at Eurocrypt, there was a really nice overview talk by Christian Kohlberg about these other techniques, related to obfuscation and how attackers and people who try to protect these things, how that works in practice. So it's good to state that all efforts in academia to build white box implementations have been broken. So it's completely unknown how to build a secure white box implementation of, for instance, AES, so of all the standardized approaches. But how do these attacks work in practice? So first of all, they were very white box specific. So you need to know exactly what approach was being implemented, which encodings were put on what tables, which cipher operations were exactly implemented where, and in which set of lookup tables. And if you knew this, then you could reverse engineer the code, because you could assume that they would put some code obfuscation on top of it, target the correct lookup table, and then apply your algebraic attack and extract the key. So we studied, we looked into a way how to make this a bit easier. So I will try and explain briefly how we took the attacks from the gray box model, so how people attacked hardware implementations and how that also applied to this setting of white box implementations. And our attack works automatically. It's very simple. So see, for instance, we had the chess challenge this year. So one of the challenges we created was related to white box implementation, and you could try our two tools which we released and see how it actually works in practice. You didn't need any knowledge of how this was implemented in practice. The only thing you need to know is which algorithm is implemented. So you need to know in practice there are only two choices, is it DES or is it AES? And then you can put as much code obfuscation on top as you want. We don't care. It's just ignored by our attack. So what's the ID? It's about tracing. So tracing binary. So when you look at academic papers and academic approaches, they're all nice and they're open designs. You know exactly what's going on. But in practice, what are companies doing? They don't specify at all their algorithm. And you don't get the source code, of course, although that should be possible in this attack model. But in practice, you just get a binary blob, which you can inspect. And then our initial idea was, let's try and collect information using dynamic binary instrumentation tools. And for instance, the popular tools for this are PIN for the Intel platform or FogGrind, which lots of people use for debugging or memory leakage detection. But actually, it's a much more advanced tool which can do much more things. So we wrote plugins for these tools, and we released them as open source, which allows you to trace the execution of trace the software execution. And what do I mean with this? It traces all the reads and writes into memory, so all the memory locations or the instruction locations. Then we wrote a visualizer, which visualizes these reads and writes. And then we're going to use these traces of these, so the all the memory accesses, and try to find correlations, the same way as you try to find correlations in the gray box attack model. We wrote plugins for Intel PIN and for FogGrind. And we were especially interested in FogGrind, of course, because that supports the ARM platform. So that means mobile devices. So how does just to give an example, how does a visual trace look like? This was inspired by a tool at Quark's lab. So the time is on the y-axis from top to bottom. And on the x-axis, you have the whole range of the memory addresses. And the different colors is either an access to an instruction, memory read, write, or read and write. So this is a typical picture when you execute a secure software crypto implementation. So why do we want to use this? Because our attack only needs one piece of information, and that is what kind of crypto algorithm is being implemented. And like I said, in practice, that's either AES or DES. So here, for instance, you see a trace, a visualization of a trace of a white box implementation, and the actual crypto is just the tiny bit on the bottom and large on the right. And there you can clearly see nine times four blocks. So this is a hint that it's probably AES. because the 10th round is slightly different. So you see this pattern, and then when you have your guess, it's AES, you can mount an AES-specific attack. But what if the white box is a bit smarter and it has completely unrolled its algorithm? You will just see a straight line like this, and of course this will not leak any information. Then you don't look at the code, but you just look at the data. So if you just look at the data pattern, how it fetches things from RAM, you would see 1 plus 15 nice lookup tables it accesses. So that means it's probably DES. And then we had another nice example of another white box implementation, which had also its memory access pattern sequentialized. So then it's really hard to tell what's actually going on. But look at the far right, that's the stack, and it turns out that it's really hard to hide information or access patterns on the stack. So if we zoom in on this, so this is exactly this green bar on the right. If we zoom in, you again see a nicely access pattern of 1 plus 15, so it means that probably the implementation is computing DES. Okay, so once we have decided which algorithm is actually being implemented, we could just, our idea was, let's see if the gray box attacks, so attacking a smart card for instance, if that works here as well. So the naive approach of course would be port your white box implementation to a smart card and measure the power consumption. That should theoretically work, but this is of course pretty stupid because we have much more. We're in a white box attack model, much more powerful attack model, and each bit which accesses memory is equally important. So the idea is we're going to serialize bits, and then you get the equivalent of a hardware power trace, which looks like this, just values 0 or 1, and it doesn't reveal much. It's already visually very hard to identify the multiple rounds in this trace. But if you would use autocorrelation, you would immediately see them. But once you realize what you're actually measuring and what you're doing, this would be the same as you would in hardware probe the bus, so each bit of your bus individually, and you would not measure any error. So it's an extremely powerful attack. And so the hope is, of course, that you need much fewer traces and it's much easier to extract the secret key compared to the attacks on hardware implementations where there is inherently much more noise and you cannot measure the individual bits that easily. So we went online, of course, and we tried to collect white box implementations which were publicly available. And we just said, let's check if this actually works. And to our surprise, it actually did work, something we did not expect from the beginning. So the first implementation online is from Brecht Weisseur. He put his white box implementation online in 2007. So it was a couple of years later already broken by one of these algebraic attacks. And after actually finding his implementation back on some internet archive, that was most of the work, it took only 65 traces, and a trace is just running the software implementation, which takes less than a millisecond. And then automatically our tool would just collect this trace, serialize it, and run a standard DPA attack, and the secret key was outputted. And similar for the other white box implementation. So in practice, in the hacker open source community, these open source implementations pop up in these capture the flag challenges, so at HackOU or SSTIC. So the middle two, so there we only needed 16 traces, but we should say that these were designed to be broken in a day, so on these hacker events. So they put no encodings on these lookup tables, which makes it easier for the algebraic attacks, but of course also much, much easier to find correlations. And then there was a master student, Klinec, who for his master thesis implemented the most advanced academic white box approach. Which we then used and created a challenge for ourselves. This was based on the approach by Karomi, and it uses these dual ciphers that you can represent AES in different ways. And here, actually, we needed a bit more traces. Initially, 2,000, which still is less than a second to collect these traces. But in the end, after fine-tuning the attack to this implementation, it was only 500. So that, of course, leads to the question, what's the intuition? Why do these correlation attacks actually work? And this was elaborated a bit more on FSC paper last year. The intuition behind this is that the encodings, which you put on these lookup tables, do not sufficiently hide the correlations when these keys are actually used in the implementation. So this, of course, opens a lot of potential work for follow-up quickly, because these white box implementations are deployed and used already in the wild. So what about countermeasures? So the most common countermeasure in the hardware community is that you are going to try and create random masks or random delays. You're going to mask values. But we're in the white box attack model, so we assume that the user has full control over your platform. So if you just query a random number, I can just set the entropy to zero, because you can assume I'm root, for instance, on my Android phone, and thereby disabling the entropy and your countermeasure doesn't work anymore. So this approach does not seem to be the right path. So what about having some sort of static random data in the white box? Another countermeasure is based on threshold implementations, which they use in hardware. That seems like an interesting approach to go for here as well. And of course, more on the hacker side of things, what about detecting if you run in such a DBI framework, detecting if you run within FileGrind or a debugger? But it seems like in the hacker community there are lots of papers who introduce new techniques how to detect this, and then other techniques how to get around this. Of course, so DCA, so this attack, it's not a holy grail. It might fail when you use large encodings on these lookup tables, because then there's no correlation anymore between the in and the output. But that means you get larger lookup tables, and things actually might become impractical, too large and too slow in practice. And moreover, the original algebraic attacks will all still work. So after we put this online, other people, so most notably the people from Riskier, they looked at this as well, so independently, and they look more at software fault attacks, so the other type of attacks we know from the Greybox community, and that approach was very successful as well. And they showed that if you, in this white box attack model, you just flip a couple of bits in these lookup tables, even if there are encodings on top of them, it's similar as a fault attack, and you can extract the secret key material as well. So we released all our software we use, so the visualizer, the tracer, and the code we created to actually perform a CPA attack or a DPA attack, because to our surprise we were not able to find any open source CPA tool, together with all the scripts for the implementations I showed earlier which we attacked, so people could actually can try and do these attacks themselves. So if you feel encouraged, please come and help and extend these tools. If you know of white box implementations which we could try and test, let us know. We're always interested in extending our tools and adding more expertise or test countermeasures, for instance. So to conclude, it's clear that software-only solutions become more and more popular, especially in the HCE environment. And they rely heavily on white box crypto. The attack I quickly described is just the counterpart of the DPA attacks from the hardware community. You don't need any expertise. It's just a matter of you download the tool and you run it against your white box attack if you know which algorithm is being implemented. And this, of course, raises the question that the level of security and especially maturity of at least all the white box schemes we tested is very questionable. We could easily break all of them. And this gives rise to a couple of questions. So, for instance, asymmetric crypto. There are companies who offer solutions for asymmetric cryptography. So think RSA, think ECDSH. But actually, in academia, it's a completely open question how to do this. So it would be interesting to have if people would start to study this in academia as well. Because in industry, they keep all their design secret. And I think there's a need, we need a way to measure the real security level somehow, like we do in hardware implementations, the security of such software solutions. So this is just the beginning, I would say. So probably we will see much more advanced attacks and countermeasures, of course, and then attacks on these countermeasures in the near future. And that, yeah, that leaves us with the final question, which I don't know the solution to. What is actually the real level of these white box schemes which are applied in these HE solutions, which are currently implemented on our mobile phones? Thank you.
Great. We have a minute or two for questions, please.
Hello. I'm Dmitry Horatoch from Luxembourg. You mentioned that your tool can be used in the cases where some additional obfuscation is applied, and that was not a bit clear for me. So did you test it on some implementations of AES where it's like within a group of, I know, some garbage code that does nothing, or you used only implementations where like carefully designed lookup tables? And do you think that using obfuscated code where 99% doing some completely unrelated to AES stuff can be a countermeasure?
So yes, we did try it on code where code obfuscation or garbling of the code was present. So a good countermeasure indeed is if you put random delays or random garbage at places, because then if you want to try to do the correlation, it becomes much more difficult. But then it's because it's the full control over everything, you could just see which steps were not used subsequently. And then it would be, so we tried this, and then it was very easy to write a tool which would just more or less align your traces and remove all the garbage out again. So that is when you include garbage code, but when you do real code obfuscations or transformations on the code, that is simply ignored because we just execute the code and look at the addresses being accessed, and that's the only thing we need. So if there's code obfuscation, we simply don't care.
Most of the cryptography that we study at this conference or that we discuss here is either designed to protect the user or to empower the user. White box cryptography does not do this. So if you view it like that, how do you evaluate working on white box cryptography from a moral standpoint?
It's a very good question. Indeed, so it does not protect the user. It's protecting the implementation or the entity providing the implementation. So it's I don't know morally or philosophically how one should categorize these things. It's a good question.
I mean for quite literally how you evaluate it.
So in my opinion, I think there is a use for white box implementations for sure, because how else would one try to protect, if there's no hardware secure element or something available, how would you protect how would you want to implement, for instance, a payment solution in software? I mean, there is a need for this, so there is a need for white box crypto.
There are companies that are doing that, by the way. There are companies that are selling white box crypto to protect credentials and keys for you on your mobile. They're crap, but they're doing it.
I was only going to mention that there are other applications here, you know, like if you don't have hardware and you want to build an ATM or some other machine, which, you know, where the owner of the machine, and really in some sense the user of the machine, has a legitimate interest in keeping it secure because you don't want someone to, you know, to sabotage the ATM and steal all the money out of it or what have you.
Yeah, but for ATM it's...
Exactly.
So in most use cases, it's often hardware, but here it's, but I agree. There are lots and lots of other use cases, yes.